Good morning, everybody, and welcome. Belated Happy New Year to everybody on the call. And delighted to welcome everybody to the first Yardstick webinar of 2022. We'll be doing one of these a month. And really delighted today that we're joined by some great company, Alex and Connor from VouchedFor. And today we're going to be talking about, it might be the longest webinar title that we've ever come up with, but today we're going to be talking about turning clients into advocates, and also on the back of that, increasing the number of recommendations you receive. And we're going to be talking about that with insights from over 250,000 reviews on VouchedFor. That's a massive number when you think about it, 250,000 people reviewing their advisor or planner on VouchedFor. Really is a truly amazing number. But in time-honoured tradition, if anybody who's joined us before, I'm going to kick off the presentation in a minute, but I'm going to hand over to Dan Campbell, our Head of Branding, for today's housekeeping.
Sure thing. So a few housekeeping points for me. So I'm Dan. I usually say I'm Phil's unglamorous assistant on these webinars, but funnily enough, I've had one or two emails saying that I am quite glamorous in my own very obscure way. So make of that what you will, I suppose, kind but untrue. So my job, as always, is to make sure everything's running smoothly, keep us on track and on time. And that means that if you do spot any odd behavior with sound or the way the screen's being shared, let us know in the chat and I'll push a few buttons my end. As regards to odd behavior from Phil, Alex or Connor, well, I can't control that, I'm afraid. So some important questions that we usually get. Firstly, yes, a recording of this will be sent out later on, so you'll have plenty of time to rewatch and absorb all the information that's shared today. And secondly, these sessions work better with lots and lots of questions, right? So don't be afraid to get stuck in. There are two ways you can do that. So the first is in the chat function at the bottom, and the second is in the little Q&A box. I'll be monitoring both, so everything will be swept up. And I'll be reading them out at natural breaks along the way. So what I will ask Alex and Connor to do is just come to me at those points and I'll sort of read them out. I'm sure Phil will have a few questions as well. So we'll all learn something there. Without further ado, over to you, Phil, Alex and Connor.
Thanks, Dan. Thank you. As I say, welcome to everybody. First webinar of 2022. This is what we're going to be talking about today. So we're going to start off by talking about the journey that people take from being suspect to advocate. We'll talk about a bit of theory there. We'll talk about the behaviours that are proved to lead to greater advocacy. Clearly, we want to create a larger proportion of our clients, in terms of larger proportions possible, into advocates. We're going to talk about how firms can increase the number of recommendations that they receive. Three keys to passionate advocacy, that's in the Alex and Connor session. The blind spots which reduce advocacy, and then we're going to come back to me and I'm going to talk about some of the practical things that you and your team can be doing with your marketing to increase advocacy, you know, give you some things that you can go away and implement in your business. Just to emphasize Dan's points though, please do question. Everyone gets more out of these sessions if we get questions, if we get comment, if we get feedback, and by all means challenge us. If you think that myself in particular, less so Alex and Connor, but myself in particular, are talking complete rubbish, then please do say so, because we don't have all the answers. And we only get better as a business and get better helping you out there market your business. And if we get challenged, we improve as well. So please question, comment, feedback, and challenge. But I want to start with this journey from suspect through prospect, client, and advocate. I think it's really important that we understand this. I've talked about this quite a few times, so apologies if people on the call have already heard it, but it probably bears repeating. So we want, on your behalf, and you want, this larger proportion of your client bank to be advocates for you. So this journey, it's a long one, and it starts at the suspect stage. Now for us, as marketers, a suspect is somebody who knows you as a business, but you don't know them yet. So Andrew, I can see you on the call from Berry, and let me pick on you. So if somebody knows the Berry & Oak business, knows Andrew because they've driven past the office, they've been recommended to Andrew, they've seen some of Berry & Oak's excellent social media posts. So they know, they're aware of the firm, they're aware of Berry & Oak, but Berry & Oak aren't aware of them yet. That means the person's in the suspect stage. The suspect is when someone knows of you or your firm, but you don't know them yet. Prospect is when a suspect has made contact. They've emailed in, completed an online inquiry form, picked up the phone, and made a request through VouchedFor to get in touch. But they've got in touch and they've started a conversation with the advisor or planner. So at that point, they're at prospective client stage, and I just shorten that to prospect. I know some people get a bit wound up by the word prospect, but it's simply a shortening of prospective client. So after prospect, now clearly some prospects won't become clients, the majority won't become clients. Typically conversion rates we see 1 in 3, 1 in 4. But the next stage on from prospect is client, and that's pretty obvious, it's where someone's paying you a fee for a service. And then the stage after that is where the client becomes a genuine advocate for the business. They're a genuine advocate for your business. And it's massively important that we turn as many clients into advocates as possible, because strong businesses, really strong businesses that have a good flow of new inquiries, a large proportion of their clients recommending them on, are built on powerful advocacy. And advocates they'll act as critical friends. They will, in the nicest possible way, tell you when something can be improved, but they're happy to remain as a client and they're happy to advocate for you. They want you to be improved. They want you to be as good as possible. So they act as critical friends. They also provide social proof. And what I mean by that is that they'll leave Google reviews and VouchedFor reviews. They will complete client surveys. They will appear on videos. I often say, if you ask the right clients in the right way, they will appear on videos. So advocates will provide social proof. And they will also recommend you to other people. And that's really crucial. They'll recommend you to other people, but also advocates will recommend you to the right people as well. And a genuine advocate won't recommend you to somebody that you can't help. They don't want to waste both parties' time, but they will recommend you to the right people. So advocacy is massively powerful. Businesses, strong businesses, are built on advocacy. And as I say, they'll act as critical friends, they'll provide social proof, and they'll recommend you to others. And from a recommendation perspective, use this slide a lot. Advocacy helps you close these two gaps. And if you want to improve the number of recommendations you receive, massively important that we close these two gaps. The first gap is the gap between the proportion of clients who say they will recommend you, in theory, and then those who actually do. Now, our research shows that around 94.99% of clients would recommend their financial planner on to other people. But only about 35% have recommended their planner on in the past 12 months. And that's a big gap, really big gap. So the first thing we need to do is get that bottom figure closer to the top. And we do that through a variety of different ways, but obviously one of them is improving advocacy. The second gap we need to close is the gap between the number of people who have been recommended to you, 35% in that case, and the proportion who actually get in touch and actually take a call to action to get in touch. And again, advocacy can help there, because there's a big difference between someone just giving a potential client the name of their planner, compared to giving them the name with a glowing recommendation, passing a business card, passing a brochure over, even doing the introduction by email. Big, big difference there. So from a recommendation perspective, we need to close those two gaps. And we do that partly through advocacy. And today's all about how we improve advocacy. First thing we need to do is recognize the importance of it. And clearly everyone who's turned up today has done that. They recognize the importance of advocacy. And we follow the evidence, and then we make changes in the business. We're going to talk a bit about some of the practical changes, but I'm going to hand over to Alex and Connor now to talk about the evidence. So this is where we do a change of screens. Let's see if we can do this slickly, guys. I'm going to stop my screen share. And you guys can share your screen.
All right, works. Many thanks, Phil. Good morning to you all. I hope you're all well and have had a good start to the year. So what are we going to cover? I'll briefly share the inspiration for our new safeguard system, which you may have read about in the press. And then I'll hand over to Connor to talk you through the clever bits. To set the scene, there's been important progress within the advice space over the last 10 years or so, from RDR through to more recently the proposed consumer duty and vulnerable client papers. The direction of travel is very much towards better consumer protection and a greater focus on client experience. And many of our members have told us that they're keen to accelerate this. What we've realized is that there's a lot more that we could and should be doing to help here. As the UK's largest review site for financial advisors, we have a lot of data that shows us what great client experience looks like. There's just over 3,600 verified members on the platform now. They're backed by just over 250,000 client reviews. And those client reviews measure client sentiment to each stage of the client journey. So from first impression reviews left after an initial meeting through to client reviews typically left by a new client, and then annual follow-up reviews left every 12 months thereafter. What we wanted to do is go further than this, and we've spent a lot of time over the last year really interrogating our data. We've been speaking to advisors as well, advice firm bosses and clients, to home in on the most powerful client experience drivers. Now, these are the factors that make the biggest positive difference to client experience. And this process has ultimately led us to Safeguard. Safeguard sets out to help firms improve client experience and more specifically drive these three goals: making great first impressions, increasing new client conversion rate, delighting existing clients, promoting advocacy and retention, and safeguarding clients' best interests, mitigating risk. Safeguard works by using carefully engineered client questions, which help firms understand how they're doing against these three goals, what's going well, and crucially, how they can drive improvement in a really kind of objective way. It's a distinct but related system to our VouchedFor review platform, in the sense that you can collect feedback entirely privately through Safeguard to generate MI and help you improve client experience. And then if you wish to, you can essentially flick a switch to put the relevant parts of that feedback onto the public VouchedFor platform in the form of reviews. So one feedback form, which can drive kind of internal MI and help improve client experience. And then if you wish, also drive kind of external marketing value too. I hope that makes sense. I'm now going to hand over to Connor, who's going to talk through some of the early insights from the system, particularly relating to that second goal, given the theme of today.
Very good. Thanks, Alex. Good morning, everyone. Yeah, so the theme of today, obviously, is more around that goal number two, delighting existing clients, promoting advocacy and retention. And the first thing to talk about is the main stat that we look at for this advocacy goal. And a question that we ask in our review forms is, in what circumstances would you recommend your advisor? Now, only 1% of clients say that they wouldn't recommend their advisor at all. And slightly different to Phil's number, but in the same sort of ballpark. And I think that really reflects the strength of the experience that almost all advisors are delivering across the industry. But where we focus is actually on the difference between the next two options. So I would consider recommending my advisor to certain people. 57% of clients say that. And 42% of clients say I would be a passionate advocate for my advisor. And according to our data, it's those passionate advocates who really do most of the recommending and the most effective recommending. And what we found is that, you know, by really focusing on converting more of their clients into passionate advocates, actually most firms could double the number of client referrals that they receive, which is really exciting. And so we've really dug into what are the specific things that advisors and firms can do to do that, to create more passionate advocates out of their clients. And we found three key sort of areas that they can focus on to build on that. Those are building strong relationships with clients, building the client's confidence in the service, and finally using data to focus your efforts to celebrate success and to understand and improve on any blind spots there may be in that experience. And so what I'm going to do is effectively go through each of these three areas one by one, and looking at the specific data points that we capture, and you know, hopefully that's helpful to understand and you know, see some practical areas where you can focus to really drive advocacy in your business. So focusing on the first one now, building strong relationships with your clients. The first point here is around the frequency of communication between an advisor and their clients. And the question that we ask is, how often do you speak with your advisor? There's a real distribution. You know, many clients speaking to their advisor once a year, and many speaking more than four times a year. But what's clear is, and the clear trend we can see is that the more a client and an advisor speak, the more likely it is that a client is to become a passionate advocate. And just to explain this chart you can see on screen here at the moment, the blue bars are the proportion of reviews that respond to each of these options in the question. So 20% of clients say that they meet their advisor once a year or fewer, 48% two to four times a year, 32% more than four times a year. And the green line is the proportion of those clients who've answered in that way that are passionate advocates. So you can see that 59% of clients who meet their advisor more than four times a year are passionate advocates, relative to only 33% who meet them once a year or fewer. So one area to focus on is frequency of communication. Access is also huge. The question that we ask to understand this is, between meetings, when would you contact your advisor? And again, you know, there's a really strong correlation here between the client feeling able to reach out to their advisor and ask any questions, even if they're not necessarily super urgent or super important, and the degree of advocacy that they're willing to give for their advisor. Most clients here are saying that they'd be quite willing to reach out to their advisor whenever they have a question, but there are a minority who would wait only for an important question or would wait for the next meeting. The third point here is around the actual nature of the relationship between the client and the advisor. And we often think that, you know, in order to be comfortable recommending an advisor onto your network, onto your friends or family, there has to be a degree of trust there with the advisor. And I think one of the ways we get at that through our review form is by asking the question, what topics do you discuss with your advisor? And the options for that question are really focused on, would you be comfortable talking about personal challenges that you're facing with your advisor? So things like bereavement, things like divorce, things like health challenges you may be going through. And a significant of minority of clients wouldn't be comfortable talking about those topics with their advisor. And those clients are also less likely to be passionate advocates for those advisors. So really building that strong trust and that rapport with the clients can really boost the degree of advocacy there. So not only are those three factors really important in themselves in terms of generating advocacy with clients, they also sort of have a knock-on impact in that advisors who have really strong relationships with certain clients tend to be much more comfortable asking those clients to recommend them to you know, their friends and family and so on. And actually, you know, not many clients have been asked that. So we asked the question, has your advisor asked you to recommend them to people that you know? And 76% of clients haven't been asked to recommend. But those that have been are much more likely to be passionate advocates than others. So it's not something clearly that most advisors do, but it may be worth considering for certain clients where it feels like you may end up with more recommendations. It can be really effective, particularly when clients are asked more than once, up to 63% passionate advocacy there. So that's that first section on building strong relationships with your clients. I'll pause here. We've covered a lot so far. I wonder if there are any questions, Dan, that have come out.
Yeah, there certainly are. So
great stuff.
All three questions that we've got are around that slide, how often do you speak with your advisor? So it may be worth popping back to that just for a second. So two of the questions essentially ask, can we define speak? So is it touch points, picking up the phone, sending out other communications such as email newsletters, for example? Let's just sort of firm that definition up.
Yeah, so we're really focused on actual conversations between clients and their advisors. We ask other questions in the form in terms of like correspondence that's received from by the client. So we're talking about, speaking, sort of verbal communication. That can be over the phone, that can be in person, and that could be over video call, obviously, as well.
Lovely, thanks. So next question is from David, who says, so the question with how often do you speak references the number of reviews in the bar there. So which is it? Can we explain the correlation a little bit there between number of reviews and then how often we speak with the advisor?
Sure. Yeah. So what the chart shows is that maybe if I pick out the one on the right hand side to start off with. So that bar shows that 32% of the reviews that we've received in response to this question say that they speak to their advisor more than four times per year. Okay. So that distribution of the blue bars you can see shows that, you know, 20% of people of reviews left, which corresponds to, you know, the number of clients are speaking to their advisor once a year or fewer, 48% two to four times a year, and 32% more than four times a year. And then the correlation there you can see is around the relationship between the green line and those three categories. So the more that they're speaking to the clients, the more likely they are to be a passionate advocate.
Brilliant.
Hopefully that's a bit clearer.
Yeah, that's excellent. So next few questions are all about asking for referrals. So a question in from Harry, who asks, from your data, is there a right or wrong or even best way to ask clients to recommend their friends?
So I think that there's early indications in our data that asking the right clients, as defined by, you know, the nature of relationship between the client and the advisor, is kind of key. And it may well be worth spending time making sure that, for example, the client is confident that they're on track to achieving their goals, which is one of the other things, before asking them for that recommendation, because we know that, you know, those are the factors that can generate advocacy in their own right. And so asking then for recommendations for those clients is almost like a multiplier effect on that relationship that you've already built up. But ultimately, I mean, look, it's you know your clients better than anyone else. And so it's down to the advisor's judgment to in terms of like exactly, you know, when to bring it up in the conversation, what words to use. Alex will talk a bit later. We've got a tool as VouchedFor that can help actually ask for those recommendations, but we'll leave that for a bit later on.
That's really interesting. I suppose a question I'd ask, Phil, in your referral workshops, I bet you have a lot of these questions about the way we're supposed to ask and how the question can be phrased. What are your thoughts on it?
I'm dying to come in here. So first thing, I passionately believe, this comes back to what we talked about, challenge, doesn't it? Passionately believe we shouldn't be asking for referrals. It creates a sense of obligation on behalf of the clients, which is proven to elicit negative feelings and even alienate potential clients. So what we need to do is we need to go about this in a way that doesn't create a sense of obligation from the client to the advisor or planner. And there was some research done by, I'm going to say, I think it was Investec, and a global consulting firm whose name escapes me, so I can't credit them right now, but I will do on the follow-up email. And for those, remember the 2010 general election, the first general election where we had TV debates. There was Nick Clegg, Gordon Brown, David Cameron, and probably a few others. BBC and ITV did some focus groups with a little dial on it. And as Nick Clegg, Gordon Brown, et cetera, were talking, the focus group would increase the dial or decrease the dial based on whether they were positive or negative to what was being said. Well, Investec and the global consulting firm did something similar. They got a bunch of, in the States, they got a bunch of high net worth individuals in the room. They fed them some lines that advisors and planners have traditionally used and worked out whether, and the people doing the poetry, increased or decreased the dial. And that gave us some lines that people were proven to be more positive and more positively received, and gave us some lines that were negatively received and proven to alienate. And things like, who can you refer me to? The old one, there's probably a few people as old as me on this call, about I get paid in two ways. Through fees and also recommendations. They're all proven not to work. So absolutely, there's a way of talking, and we absolutely shouldn't be asking. And for me, the six stages, we go through this in a referral workshop, we'll talk about that later on, but there's six stages to having a conversation with a client about recommendations. We absolutely should have the conversation at three different points, which we'll explain in a bit. We can use tech such as VouchedFor's referral generator tool to back that up. But long-winded answer, Dan, short version is, yes, there is definitely a way to discuss recommendations with clients.
Brilliant, thanks. So I think we'll have one more question and then we'll move on. So a question in from Philip, and it's a really interesting question. I saw recently a firm which is offering £500 travel vouchers for 3 referrals in a year. What do you think of this approach? And I'll put that to Connor and Alex first, and then I'm sure Phil's going to have an opinion on this too.
Alex, do you have a view?
Yeah, I mean, I think a lot of that ties into what Phil was just saying. You don't want to seem overly salesy or pushy in your approach. And I think offering such a high monetary incentive sends the wrong messages, personally. That said, I don't think there's necessarily anything wrong with offering some sort of incentive. And I will share our referral generator tool a bit later in the session with you, and you can see what you think about the messaging there. We give advisors the option to add an incentive if they'd like of a number of M&S vouchers. It's not quite as high as £500, but we have seen that does help drive action. We typically position it as an incentive that you can share with the person you recommend the advisor to, if it works out. So it's not just because a client might see, if they were to go out to a friend and tell that friend about an advisor, and then the friend was to learn that there'd been £500 in it for the person recommending the advisor, it doesn't quite sit right. Whereas if the incentive was something that could be shared between the two of them, it's a bit more wholesome in the approach. So I'm not totally against it, but I'd be very cautious in terms of how you deploy the message.
Yeah, that's really interesting. Phil, what's your view on paying for referrals?
I'm a bit of a pragmatist, and therefore I'd be really interested to see, Philip, whether the firm makes it work. It'd be really interesting to see whether it's a you know, the first time they've done it, or they it's been something they've been doing for a while, and that has generated recommendations for them. I can think of one firm out of all the ones we've worked with in the 5 years that the R6 has been going that have done something similar, and it has really, really worked for them. The firm themselves, they've got a very charismatic, very powerful founder and head and face of the business, and that helped. But I've only seen it work once. So Philip, I'd be interested to understand whether it's working for that firm and how long it's worked for them. There's other ways of doing it. Charitable donations can work well. We've got a firm in the Lake District, another in Otley. Relatively small firms, but that's worked really well. Charitable donations for recommendations, and it's definitely increased the number of recommendations they've received while doing something good for the community, a hospice and a food bank. So I've seen that work well. And also to create advocacy, I've seen, you know, thank you cards, gifts being given, but I'm giving away loads of stuff that we did on our recommendation workshop. So short answer, pragmatic, I'd like to see the result.
Brilliant, thanks for that. So we will move on, but I will just quickly mention that we've had a few comments, not questions, that say exactly echo what you've just said, Phil, where charitable donations leave a sort of a pleasant taste in people's mouths, and also just a thank you box of wine, hamper, you know, nice things, not necessarily for an actual referral in this person that's commented's case. It's more just a case of, you know, here you are as a client, here's a nice thing, and that itself encourages further referrals down the line. So yeah, shall we move on to the next section then, guys?
Sounds good, thank you. Cool. So the next section is all around building the client's confidence in your service. And this section is a bit shorter. There's two massive things that can be done here, and I'll cover those. So, one of the questions we ask is how confident are you that you're on track to achieving your goals? So the goals that you're working on with your advisor, and we see that being sort of firmly on track to those and being sort of clear on how on track you are is absolutely massive for advocacy. So you can see that the difference between I'm confident that I'm on track to achieve my goals and I couldn't be more confident that I'm on track to achieving my goals is huge. So it's a difference between 36% passionate advocacy and 66% passionate advocacy. So 66% of clients who couldn't be more confident that they're on track to achieving their goals are passionate advocates. And what's interesting is that, you know, only 22% of clients say that they couldn't be more confident, which means a really substantial majority of clients, there is room for improvement in this area. So it's really worth thinking about, you know, what is the process? What is the right way of talking with each of your clients to really help give them that confidence that, you know, the stuff you're working on is getting them to where they want to get to and where you've agreed in terms of the goals that they should be getting to. So this is a really big one. The next one, you know, similarly important is high quality conversations around risk. So the way we get at this through our form is by asking, how confident are you that you understand the potential disadvantages of your advisor's recommendations? And again, it's that difference between I'm confident and I couldn't be more confident in terms of you know, understanding the potential disadvantages or understanding the risk involved with those recommendations. And what's interesting here as well is that actually for older clients, it becomes even more important. So it becomes far and away the most important factor for the 65 and over age group that question of confidence that you're taking the appropriate amount of risk and really understanding the potential disadvantages there. So it's, you know, for those who couldn't be more confident in the potential disadvantages, 72% of them are passionate advocates. And I think it reflects the nature of the conversations that are held around there and how often you're talking about that and the depth in which you're talking about it as well. Cool. So yeah, very brief section there. I don't know if there've been any more questions, Dan, or should we move on?
No, nothing worth pointing out just yet.
Cool. All right. Very good. Cool. So the third section here is around using data to focus your efforts. And this is where we come back to, you know, the actual practicalities of the safeguard system that we've developed. And what we find is that, you know, client experience data can really help advisors find the blind spots that are limiting advocacy. And I think there's a huge opportunity here for almost every single advisor. And a really interesting stat that we've seen throughout this, if you think to each of the different data points we've talked about so far, only 2% of reviews, so roughly 2% of clients, say that their advisor is doing each one of those things perfectly, right? So for every advisor, there is likely room for at least some degree of of improvement. And how do you do that? Well, you have to really understand where you are and where the blind spots are before you can improve. So what you can see on screen now is actually real data for 5 advisors in one firm that comes out of our safeguard system. And these are the passionate advocacy percentages for those 5 real advisors. So for just to explain what that means, so for advisor one on the left-hand side there, 82% of their clients say that they're passionate advocates. In contrast, for advisor 5, 27% of their clients say that they're passionate advocates. And so there's a real span of performance here. And we see this across lots and lots of the firms that we work with and across the industry as a whole. There's a massive span in terms of some advisors are consistently driving advocacy and some have quite a way to go in order to catch up there. And what's interesting here as well is that you can see the industry average cutting across. We do make that benchmarking data available, so firms and advisors can see how they stack up, not only to others in their firm, but also to the industry as a whole. So if I'm advisor 5, or if I'm the ND of this firm, the thing that jumps out to me, of course, is, okay, advisor 5, 27%. Why are they lower than the others? How can they improve? What are they doing well, but also how can they improve? And so if we dive in, and this is the sort of data that we're giving to individual advisors and to the management of firms, to really help them understand the blind spots there. And so this is real data for that advisor. Advisor 5 is obviously anonymized. And what we can see is that they're actually doing well in some areas. So in terms of client confidence that they're on track to achieve their goals, they are above the average for the industry. Okay. They're slightly below the average for the industry in terms of the client feeling able to contact that advisor, in terms of the frequency of communication. But the really clear area and the clear blind spot for them, if they want to boost the degree of advocacy in their client bank, is the degree of rapport that they have built up. And that comes back to that question we talked about before about what topics would you discuss with your advisor. Maybe it's not rapport, but it's trust. But that's the sort of area where there's a real blind spot for them potentially, and it's the one area they should focus on for the most improvement. And so thinking about how this works in practice, what we've actually built is dashboards, a series of dashboards which give really actionable data that take the information out of the sort of review forms to present, you know, the blind spots, the areas for improvement, both to the management of firms, but also to individual advisors. But also crucially, it's the areas where, you know, advisors are doing well. And that's the thing that's really struck us, I think, across looking at the data that we've had so far, is that, you know, by and large, advisors do a phenomenal job for their clients. And one of the things we really want to do as part of this is celebrate that. And I think that having this sort of data set allows us to do that with, you know, with real confidence. And so, you know, that's a big part of what Safeguard is all about as well. The other interesting point I'd sort of try and make here is that when we first set out to develop this system, we really thought we'd get much more interest from the larger firms. But actually, we've been really encouraged at the fact that we've had loads and loads of interest from small firms and also from sort of individual advisors who think that, you know, it can really help them understand their clients better and improve the experience that they're delivering. So I want to hand back to Alex now to talk about a few other ways in which you can drive advocacy, which are a bit different from Safeguard.
Great stuff. Thanks, Connor. So yeah, we just wanted to close out with a couple of sort of further thoughts, which aren't necessarily directly related to Safeguard in terms of how you can drive advocacy. So the first is around just building social proof, something I know Phil writes and talks a lot about. What we found is that 79% of clients are more likely to refer to you having read your reviews. That's not to say the clients in question didn't think their advisors were good to begin with. It's simply the case that referring to a financial advisor is a big deal, and clients like the reassurance of knowing that it's not just them who thinks that the advisor is great. Secondly, in terms of encouraging clients and indeed prospective clients to read your reviews, one of the best ways to do that is to invite them to review you. So if you invite them to review you, and it's easy and tempting within that journey to read reviews left for you by other clients, that's really powerful. Arguably, particularly if you're a prospective client and you're able to see all the great things that the advisor's clients have said about them. Thanking clients for reviewing you is really important, particularly if that's helped you achieve a particular milestone, such as perhaps top rated status on our platform, or it could be a particular number of reviews or that kind of thing. We spoke a lot earlier about getting the message right, and our referral generator tool, which I'll show you, it offers some ideas. Frankly, whether you're a VouchedFor member or not, there's some food for thought within there. So what this is an email that our members can choose to trigger to a selection of their clients. It comes from VouchedFor. What it does is it thanks the client for leaving a review for the advisor, in this case, Adam, and says what that's helped him achieve. So it's helped him qualify as a top-rated advisor in the 2022 top-rated financial advisor guide that we published. It then recaps our mission to help everyone access the best advice to them and says, to that end, we'd be very grateful if you would introduce Adam to anyone you know who may need help with their finances by sharing the unique link below, which links through to all of his reviews. So why is this message powerful? You know, why does it generate engagement? There's a couple of thoughts here. So firstly, it's personalized. The client gets the sense that they're part of your success. They've been a key part. Their review has had an impact and helped you, in this case, qualify for our guide. That's really important. Secondly, as previously covered, the client's able to see that it's not just them who thinks that you're great. Their review was one of many that helped you achieve that status, which builds their confidence to refer. Thirdly, anyone that your client forwards this on to would be able to see that it's not just your client, their friend, who thinks that you're great, but others do as well. And I think a really key point here, and I often see advisors get this slightly wrong, it is positioning client recommendations in terms of kind of the mission of helping more people access advice. You know, you guys on the call know better than anyone the power of great advice and the massive problem we have in this country with the fact that far too many people who could benefit from advice are yet to seek it out due to lack of confidence, whatever it might be. And I think it's so important to get that across. The fact that actually recommending an advisor is something that clients can do to help their friends, help the people that they know, as opposed to a way to help the advisor grow their business. I think, you know, conveying that is so incredibly important in how you position recommendations. Hope that was useful. That's everything from us. Delighted to take any further questions, though I think you had, I don't know, we'll pause for questions now, we'll go into your other slides, Phil.
Dan, shall we, if you want to take your screen share off, guys, I'm going to share my screen again. Bear with me. Right, so Hopefully everyone can see that. Dan, is that looking okay?
Yeah, it looks good to me.
Yeah, cool. So as is the case, always the case with Yardstick webinars, we want to leave you with some practical things that you can go away and embed in your business, things that you can actually do to make a genuine difference. And I think what Alex and Connor have been saying about the correlation between speaking to clients more frequently and advocacy is really important. It would be interesting to note the additional workload that maybe doing 4 annual review meetings would place on a planner. Probably not necessarily the most realistic thing in the world. So what I did was I put together a few thoughts about additional touch points that you can pull into your processes. And all of these can be put into a process. So speaking to clients doesn't necessarily, I guess, I might be wrong, Connor, but it doesn't necessarily mean meetings. You just mean picking the phone up. And picking the phone up and all these points just show that you care. It genuinely shows that you care and does give the client the opportunity to come back with any concerns they've got at that time. So potentially firms could diarise quick calls, diarise quick check-ins to clients, maybe that are unexpected. And those quick check-ins could be a WhatsApp message if your client uses WhatsApp. And actually, in our client surveys that we do on behalf of advisors and planners, 80, 90% of clients are using WhatsApp. It's a massive communication tool and a massively untapped communication tool. So quick check-ins, scheduling little unexpected calls, I think are really important. Other ways of talking to clients, webinars and events. Seeing more and more firms do webinars. I was on a call with a firm yesterday who were doing a webinar a quarter for their clients and prospects, and they're going really well, generating great feedback from clients, no doubt improving advocacy, and giving a touch point with a prospect. It's a terrible phrase, but walking them up that value ladder until they're ready to jump off a webinar onto a meeting. So webinars, relatively low cost to put on, relatively easy to do. Actually, I shouldn't be saying that. We're running a webinar. They're really difficult to do. Yeah, they take ages to organise, but no, really, they're not too difficult to do. And events, as we move into the year, hopefully we can do more face-to-face events. I was chatting to one firm who did a garden party in September. That's more than paid for itself in recommendations from new clients directly from that garden party. Other touch points, newsletters. Guys, quarterly isn't enough on newsletters. We talk to firms who say, I don't want to bombard my clients. Well, if you have that mind, then maybe what the content isn't valuable. So if you're adding value, do it 12 times a year rather than 4 times a year. If you're not adding value, you shouldn't be sending a newsletter in the first place. So a quarterly touch point with the newsletter, again, really important. Another thing I see firms not doing is connecting and engaging with clients on social media. So if you have a list of clients, go and find them on LinkedIn, go and find them on Facebook. Some of them might be on Twitter as well, and engage with them, connect with them, share their content, comment on their content, make yourself useful to them. And again, another little touch point. I saw this and thought of you messages. You really know your clients. You know whether they like cricket, football, rugby, whether they're theatre or cinema goers or whatever it is. You know your clients. So if you see something that you think your clients will be interested in, a little I saw this and thought of you message. Really, really important. Top 10 films of 2020 or top 10 films that are coming 2020. You know you've got a client who's a film buff, send them the link. So those little, I saw this and thought of you messages. And then create more wow moments. In the invite for this webinar, we talked about the fact that you can't create advocacy by just sending a birthday card or a Christmas card. Send more wow moments, or create them, I should say. So your client's children graduate, send the child something. It's your client's golden wedding anniversary. Send them something. Just the fact that you knew, the fact that you knew and the fact that you did something about it really will impress clients. And as I say, start to create advocates. And those wow moments, you can diarise on your back office system. You can build processes and we can work brilliantly. As Alex said earlier, correlation between advocacy and reviews, put that point about the fact that when your client, when someone leaves you a review, they're going to read the other reviews. I thought that was a brilliant point and really, really important. So I'm just conscious of time. We would always use Google and VouchedFor. Really important that we use both platforms. In our experience, for every one Google review a firm gets, they'll get three or four on VouchedFor. It's easier to get reviews on VouchedFor than it is Google, frankly, but Google is still important. And that should be done by running an initial project and then amending your processes to keep them topped up. Really, really important there. And a few other things. Regularly reminding clients of the purpose of financial planning and their aspirations. This time last year, we did a webinar with Carl Richards. And Carl talked really well about that. And I'll include a link to what Carl said in the follow-up to today's, because I thought that was really, really powerful. And then constantly prove to your clients that they're on track and remind them. Connie, you talked about there being a correlation between being on track and advocacy. So we need to remind them about, well, what we're on track to do, and that's about purpose. And Carl talked about putting the purpose on the front of the plan. And then reminding them that they're on track. And using checklists. Carl's really good on this, and I'll put that link in. Brett Davidson's really good on checklists. So using checklists to show everything that you do. I think Carl in that video talked about 17-point checklist. I'll put a link to the video in the follow-up to this. But use checklists, really important. And finally, Connor, you talked about a correlation between advocacy and talking about recommendations. And people need to, Hannah's advisors need to consistently have that recommendation conversation. Yeah, it was really telling, Connor, your stats about how infrequently advisors do it. Can't remember the number, but it was sub 10% that do it on a regular basis. And there's a conversation to be had, we're not asking, there's a conversation to be had in introduction meetings, at sign-up meetings, and at review meetings. And there's ways of doing it. There's ways of doing it that are proved to work, and there's ways of doing it that actually are proved to alienate people. And a quick 20-second plug. In today's, when we send out the recording from today, there will be a special offer to everybody who signed up for today's webinar to attend our next recommendation workshop. We ran one in December. We'll be running another one in the next few weeks. And that recommendation workshop talks about the theory of recommendations. It also talks about the Dirty Dozen, which are 12 reasons why advisors and planners get fewer referrals than they should. And we talk about the things you can do to solve the Dirty Dozen. It talks about best practice, talks about how to have the conversation, the six steps to structure that conversation, what doesn't alienate clients, what does. And we also talk about the role of incentives, whether it's charitable donations, travel vouchers, as Philip was talking about. So quick plug for that. We will give a discount on the next recommendation workshop to everybody who is on this webinar. So that's me. I'm conscious that a few questions for Dan to work through. I've got a question for Alex and Connor, which we'll come to as well. I'll leave these slides up, these next couple of slides up, so everyone's got our contact details, and we go from there. Dan, over to you.
Brilliant. So let's see how many of these questions we can work through. So I'll start with the more commonly asked ones. So we've got two that essentially ask, does contact with the wider team help client advocacy, or is it only with the advisor? And let's put that to Alex and Connor first, and then we'll field it to Phil, because I'm sure he'll have a view as well.
So yeah, my view on that is that ultimately, if you look at the client experience drivers, which are measuring things like confidence, they're on track to achieve goals, frequency of communication, various other things like how clear they are on documents and such like, you know, the wider team has a really important part to play in driving all of those. The feedback we are collecting is specifically about the advisor rather than that wider team, but the wider team's efforts are definitely reflected in the results.
Yeah, that's great. Phil, what's your view?
I don't think I've got a lot to add to Alex there, to be honest. I agree with Alex.
Brilliant. So let's have The next question from Joy. Now, Joy asks a brilliant question. So many of these strategies seem mostly relevant to the advisor-client relationship. Is there anything you can add regarding the referral advocacy process with professional connections?
Absolutely. If I could jump in with a quick thought on this, it's a great question, Joy. I saw a study recently, I can't recall the source, but I'll try and find it so that we can share it afterwards. But it pointed to the fact that the single biggest barrier to professional referrals is not that the accountants or solicitors in question already have advisor relationships in place. It's trust. It's simply wanting to be absolutely sure that their client's going to have a great experience. And so to that end, you know, all the social proof points that we've been talking about, all that right messaging, et cetera, is very powerful with professional connections as much as it is with clients.
Yeah, that's great. Phil, what would you add regarding professional connections referrals?
Well, I think there's probably a series of webinars we could do on the back of professional connection webinars, but I agree with Alex, it comes down to trust. We did a webinar with Dave Seeger, who's ex-Seeker Pro. I'll put a link in the follow-up to this webinar in there. And Dave talked a lot about that. But yeah, you're right, it's trust, but it's a whole range of other factors as well. Might do that on a separate webinar.
Yeah, that's the conclusion of a lot of these webinars, isn't it? It spawns so many more in the future, which is always a good thing. Phil, let's have your question next.
So I'm going to just go on a slight tangent, if that's okay. And question for obviously Connor and Alex. We talked about getting online ratings and reviews being really important. Clearly, notch up from that is qualifying for the guide, the top rated guide. And as we've got a bunch of people on this call who no doubt will have qualified for the top rated guide, I just thought we'd spend a couple of minutes, if that's okay, Alex and Connor, just talking about next steps. When's it going to be published? What assets are going to be available? So what are the next steps for the top rated guide?
Yes, absolutely. So essentially, at the moment, we're in the process of confirming exactly who's qualified, both at advisor and firm level. You may have seen us tagging some qualifiers on social media. So look out for those. And, you know, if you are one of the advisors or firms tagged, do share it. You can see that it's generating a lot of buzz. Secondly, in early Feb, we will make a variety of kind of free top rated tools available to any advisors and firms that have qualified. Added to that, their profiles on VouchedFor will list the fact that they're top rated 2022. So again, that there's lots of opportunities to share those with your clients. There's also the option to buy some sort of additional tools such as our trophy, glossy copies of the guide, that sort of thing. Our top rated store has recently opened, so look out for that. We're also going to share various tips over the next few weeks on how to really leverage top rated status and make the most of it with prospects, with clients, with professional connections as well. And I'd thoroughly recommend reading Phil's blogs on the subject as well, which are fantastic and very useful. The guide itself will be published on the 26th of March. It'll be distributed nationally in the Times to their reach of just over 1 million. And then after that, it will be published in digital form through our various media partners. And we'll also be doing some PR around it. We'll share it extensively on our social channels and encourage advisors as well to make the most of it and to tell their various contacts about the fact that they're qualified.
Thanks, Alex. It's really useful.
Right. So the main bulk of questions have been answered. Let's have one more, shall we? And then we can wrap up. So let's combine two questions into one. Let's be a bit cheeky. So a question from Philip, who asks, have you done this research for everyone on VouchedFor? How can we find out who's passionate and how many passionate clients we have? And then I'm also going to ask Andrew's question with how can we access the research data for our clients? So the question is, who have we asked? How can we find out who's passionate? And then how do we access research data for our clients in particular?
Okay. So shall I answer who have we asked and then hand over to you, Alex, for
that bit?
So we have included some of these questions in all of the review forms on VouchedFor. We will sort of, and we always have made changes to the review forms to try to get to the best combination of questions to, you know, showcase the client experience, showcase and understand the client experience that advisors deliver. And this is just sort of an evolution of that. So there's no change there. However, the full set of questions is only asked to advisors who are on Safeguard. And I'll maybe pass to Alex to answer the other bits of the question.
Yeah, absolutely. So there were a few questions. Philip, Elaine and Andrew, sort of, who I know are all VouchedFor members with great reviews. So put simply, yes, as Connor says, some of the insights that we've talked about can be gleaned from the kind of the standard VouchedFor review form. But in order to access all the insights from VouchedFor, we need to add extra questions in. We need to give you access to various dashboards. There is an additional cost to do all that. Currently works out at £30 per advisor per month. That's our pioneer rate. And we'll follow up with each of you afterwards to share exactly how you can go about getting involved if you'd like.
How are we doing, Dan?
Brilliant, absolutely brilliant. So most of those questions, I saw Alex has been answering some of the more techie ones directly with text answers in the Q&A box. So Alex and Connor, are there any that you've seen on the Q&A box remaining that you'd like to address, or many of them seem to be quite repetitive of what we've already just covered?
There's one question on the chat that I can see from Tracy Ann about sending details of signing up from VouchedFor. I think Tom mentioned about how he signed up for VouchedFor as well.
That's it, yeah, just come through. So Tom says, having never used VouchedFor, what's the easiest way to start? Is it as simple as registering and setting up a profile?
Yeah, so simply you can go to vouchedfor.co.uk and then click sign up in the top right, and then there's a form you can fill out, and then one of the team will be in touch and help explain how the platform works and how you can progress to verified membership if you'd like to. So you can do that, or alternatively, if you prefer, feel free to email me at a.whitson. I'll stick it in the chat, actually. a.whitson@vouchedfor.co.uk. Appreciate we've covered quite a lot of ground today, so there might be sort of specific questions you have before deciding whether to get involved. There we go. Oh, I'll share that just for some panelists. That's no good. You guys already know that.
We'll share your details as well, Alex, on the show note. Right. Any more for any more now?
One question that I did see in the chat a little bit earlier on, actually, from Ravi, who we know, so that's why his name popped up. I can't find the exact question, but I know the gist was, can estate planners become part of VouchedFor as well, or is it just financial advisors and planners?
It depends really on the type of estate planning you do. So there's a lot of financial advisors on VouchedFor who specialise in IHT planning and such like, and are absolutely listed on the platform. The key criteria is that they need to be CF30 qualified and authorised by the FCA, either as a senior manager or under SMCR.
Right, thank you, Alex. Thank you to everybody who attended today. I really hope you found it useful. It was a great start having Alex and Connor on here, to a great start to our webinar programme for 2022. As I said, we'll send out a recording, we'll send out all the bits and bobs we've talked about, the links, Alex's email address, etc. We'll send out the discount deal for the next recommendation workshop. And obviously, we'll see you next month for February's webinar. See you soon, everybody. Thanks, Alex. Thanks, Connor. Cheers, Dan. See you soon.
Lovely. Thanks, guys. Bye.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.